Guten Abend, herzlich willkommen im Bauhaus Dessau. Wir werden noch hier ein paar Gäste reinlassen, aber wir wollen die Zeit nicht verstreichen lassen. Wir haben einen engen Zeitplan, noch vieles vor heute Abend und auch Herr Liebeskind, den ich herzlich begrüßen möchte mit seiner Frau Nina Liebeskind, den Minister. Minister Dorgerloh, Obermeister Clemens Koschik, Beigeordnete, Stadträte, Landtagsabgeordnete und natürlich alle, die hier im Saale sind und auch die draußen in der Übertragung zuhören, heißen wir herzlich willkommen. Bevor ich zur Einleitung des Vortrages von Daniel Liebeskind zwei, drei Worte sagen will, will ich kurz den Rahmen, in dem das stattfindet, inhaltlich skizzieren. Wir haben heute Abend die Eröffnung des Triennale-Wochenendes von Dessau. Die Triennale der Moderne findet dieses Jahr zum ersten Mal statt. Es ist eine gemeinsame Initiative der Städte Berlin, Dessau und Weimar und der dortigen Bauhausinstitutionen. Und sie hat vor zwei Wochen in Berlin begonnen und endet jetzt mit diesem Wochenende hier. Sie steht unter einem bestimmten Thema, nämlich dem Thema zerstörte Vielfalt, was auch das Themenjahr Berlins in diesem Jahr ist und bezieht sich natürlich auf das 80-jährige Jubiläum des Jahres 1933 und dem damit angesprochenen Thema. Wir haben hier in Dessau mit einer Vielzahl von Akteuren dieses Wochenende vorbereitet, gemeinsam mit der Stadt. Und es ist ein Thema, was nicht nur für Berlin relevant ist, was für Weimar relevant ist, sozusagen als Ort der Weimarer Republik, sondern was in nicht geringerem Maße für Dessau relevant ist. Und das möchte ich kurz skizzieren zu Beginn, weil ich finde, dass dieser Aspekt der Geschichte der Moderne, und dazu gehört es dann doch auch, in der öffentlichen Diskussion im Bauhaus Stadt der Moderne hier auch nicht immer sagen hinreichend diskutiert und Thema ist. Und es ist eine Chance, mit diesem Triennale-Wochenende auch durchaus auf diese schwierigen Kapitel auch zu verweisen, ohne auch die Glanzzeiten und die Glückszeiten dieser Stadt zu vergessen oder zu verschatten. Ich möchte nur kurz daran erinnern, es war in Anhalt, dass die erste Landesregierung in Deutschland durch die Nationalsozialisten Mehrheit im Jahr 32 entstanden ist und der Wahlslogan der NSDAP im Wahlkampf war, das erste war die Forderung der Schließung des Bauhauses und die zweite Forderung war der Abriss des Bauhauses als Gebäude. Ersteres hat stattgefunden, zweiteres, wie wir wissen, zum Glück nicht. Hier ein Bild eines Besuches von Schulze-Naumburg in demselbigen Jahr. Schulze-Naumburg, auch jemand, der in Sachsen-Anhalt verortet ist, Saaleck in der Nähe von Naumburg, der große Gegenspieler des Bauhauses, eine interessante Figur, aber auch ein Mensch, der die Idee der entarteten Kunst formuliert hat und der eine sehr, um es mindestens zu sagen, problematische Rolle in diesem Geschehen gespielt hat, der dann selber 1933 die Hochschule in Weimar übernommen hat in seine Leitung. Das ist ein Bild von einer Collage eines japanischen Bauhausschülers. Was weniger bekannt ist, dass die Schließung des Berliner Bauhauses auch eigentlich ein Dessauer Ereignis ist. Dessau war nach wie vor Arbeitgeber der Meister. Es war zwar eine private Institution Mies van der Rohes, aber die Meister hatten noch Verträge mit der Stadt, die waren bis dorthin nicht, konnten nicht aufgelöst werden. Und nach der Machtergreifung im Januar 1933 sah die Stadt Dessau unter ihrer nationalsozialistischen Regierung die Möglichkeit, dieses zu beenden. Und die Dessauer Staatsanwaltschaft war diejenige, welche die Hausdurchsuchung im Bauhaus Berlin im April 1933 veranlasste, die dann zur Schließung des Bauhauses auch in Berlin führte. Dazu wird es morgen eine Veranstaltung geben, dazu will ich am Ende des Abends etwas sagen. Die Geschichte dieser Themas der zerstörten Vielfalt, ich möchte nur erinnern, die Bauhausbauten sind überformt worden in dieser Zeit, hier am Beispiel der Meisterhäuser, links vorher, rechts nachher. Sie sehen die verbauten Atelierfenster mit den Vorhängen. Das war das Ende dieser Periode, das Bauhausgebäude im Jahr 1945 und hier das Haus Moholy im Jahr 1945. Es gibt ein zweites Thema, was damit zusammenhängt. Es ist eben halt auch die Geschichte des Bauens in den Jahren 33 bis 45. Und uns muss einfach bewusst sein, dass ein guter Teil des der Stadt in dieser Zeit gebaut worden ist. Hier ist ein Plan dessen, was in Dessau in der Zeit gebaut worden ist. Dessau war Gauhauptstadt, sollte wachsen auf 300.000 Einwohner als eine natürlich Rüstungsindustriestadt. Es gibt diese ikonischen Bauten, wie das Anhaltische Theater, von Hitler selber eröffnet, das Polizeipräsidium, hier eine Reihe von Junkersbauten natürlich, die ich einfach exemplarisch nennen möchte. Und das ist die Ambivalenz, weil es ist natürlich eine moderne, eine zwar konservative Moderne, aber es ist auch ein modernes Bauen. Und hier noch nicht mal konservativ, im Industriebau konnte sich ja auch die Moderne noch etwas fortsetzen. Und damit verbunden ist dann halt auch das weitere Kapitel der Rüstungsproduktion, das eben halt dazu auch gehört, und dann dieses ganz finstere Kapitel von Zyklon B. Damit will ich es belassen, einfach, das ist dieser Themenkontext, den wir mit diesem Wochenende thematisieren wollen. Es war die Anregung von Minister Daugaloh, Herrn Liebeskind einzuladen, der ihn vor einem guten Jahr in den USA getroffen hat bei einer Reise. Und wir dachten, es ist ein angemessener Kontext, ihn einzuladen hierzu, weniger aufgrund seiner persönlichen Hintergründe, die es natürlich auch gibt, als ein Architekt, der sich in sehr interessanter Weise mit Zeitbrüchen, mit gesellschaftlichen Brüchen und deren architektonischen Artikulation befasst hat. Die ersten Bauten, die er realisiert hat, das Nussbaumuseum und das Jüdische Museum in Berlin, sind natürlich solche Bauten, die genau diese Umbrüche, Zäsuren thematisieren. Aber auch sein jüngeres Projekt, das Freedom Tower in New York, ist natürlich auch ein Gebäude, was eine solche Zeitzäsur thematisiert und reflektiert in einer architektonischen Weise. Und insofern fanden wir es sehr interessant, in diesem Kontext Herrn Liebeskind einzuladen, um über diesen Kontext, aber natürlich auch über die Frage, wie man die Idee des Bauhauses heute nach über 90 Jahren denken kann. An sich ist es überflüssig, Herrn Liebeskind vorzustellen. Er ist sehr bekannt, trotzdem vielleicht zur Erinnerung oder Präzisierung zwei, drei Worte. Dein Liebeskind ist in Lodz, Łódź auf Polnisch gesagt, geboren 1946, hat die ersten 10 Jahre seines Lebens dort verbracht, ist dann mit den Eltern, mit der Familie, auch den Geschwistern nach Israel emigriert, hat dort eine Musikausbildung begonnen und war ein Wunderkind als Musiker. 1970 hat er, und von dort, von Israel, sind sie in die USA gegangen, und dort gab dann auch den Wechsel von der Musik in die Architektur. Das Architekturstudium hat er dann 1970 an der Cooper Union in New York abgeschlossen und 2 Jahre später noch an der University of Essex ein Master in Architekturgeschichte und Theorie absolviert. Und dann beginnt seine berufliche Karriere. Das will ich jetzt nicht weiter ausführen, das ist Ihnen meistens auch durch die sehr bekannten Bauten bekannt. Und ich freue mich sehr, dass Sie gekommen sind. Und ein Wort zu diesem Foto. Wir haben das lange vorbereitet und wir waren sehr glücklich, dass dein Liebeskind sehr spontan, eigentlich sehr kurzfristig vor einem Jahr der Einladung zugesagt hatte. Es haben sich aber dann Schwierigkeiten ergeben. Er ist ein vielgefragter Mann. Und die Lösung, diese Schwierigkeiten zu lösen, war eigentlich eine ganz Dessau-gemäße, nämlich ein Flugzeug zu organisieren, was ihn in einer kurzen Zeit von Baden-Baden nach Dessau bringt. und ich wollte Ihnen eigentlich ein Foto zeigen vom Dessauer Flugplatz, da hat das Wetter nicht mitgespielt, er ist dann in Leipzig gelandet, aber mit einer Dessauer Maschine der Stadtwerke, die ich dafür danken will, für die Kooperation, die es möglich gemacht haben, das auch im Rahmen des Budgets zu lösen, diese Frage. Und ich denke, es ist eigentlich die richtige Art, hier in Dessau anzukommen mit dem Flugzeug. Herzlich willkommen.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. It's not the first time that I'm in Dessau and in the Bauhaus. It's an amazing place, and I wanted to share with you not just some projects, but what I think, how powerful Bauhaus is in my life. It's my work may not look like Bauhaus, but Bauhaus was not about the surface appearance. Bauhaus was a spiritual idea, cultural idea, an idea about how to create a better world, a more beautiful world. And that's what I followed actually through my education. I was educated, by the way, at Cooper Union in New York, School of Architecture, by emigres from the Bauhaus. My professor for color, Hannes Beckmann, was a famous Bauhaus photographer. His course notes for the course I took were written and commented by Kandinsky and Paul Klee. And when Hannes Beckmann went to become a head of Dartmouth art faculty, he showed me three letters of reference he had, one from Mies van der Rohe, one from Albers, and one from Marcel Breuer. So, you know, Bauhaus is not an abstract idea, and when I had a chance to be in really a head of the School of Architecture in the American Bauhaus, Cranbrook Academy of Art, which was founded by Eliel Saarinen, produced Eros Saarinen. I lived in the house of Charles Eames, Harry Bertoia, the great artists and architects and designers who took the Bauhaus idea to America. I show you these posters because I attempted to create a continuity to the Bauhaus, but with new forms, with student work, with philosophy, and with the notion that Bauhaus fostered the idea of the mind, but also of the hand, of the craftsmanship and of the working together of different disciplines. And I think that's very important, that it was not about just architecture, but about the whole world of connections to people's life. And form follows function is an easy slogan, but it's really forms follows being, forms follow everyday life. And this is really a publication, my first book, 1978, where you can see on this cover, really, I didn't go into architecture by building buildings, not at all. I went through a kind of Bauhaus course through space, through music, through many of the things that Bauhaus was so incredible as an inspiration and as an art. And these are some of early sort of works that dealt with the house, the city. These are, I share with you this process because I never actually put these things together before. This is the first time I put these images together, and I was surprised how consistent the line, maybe not point line plane of Kandinsky, maybe not Maholi Nagy, maybe not exactly the Paul Klee course on visual on visuality, maybe not exactly the Itten course on color, maybe not a course on weaving or the woodworking, but very close to exploring the vision of the Bauhaus, the vision of the Bauhaus, and how we can take that vision and implement it in the contemporary world. So the uses of collage, the fact that I delved into the different technical disciplines which the Bauhaus fostered, and that was very important for my development of architecture. And when I really started with the Rebus House, really I collected fragments and put them back together into a world that you can see has the discipline of the Bauhaus, but we are living in a different time. And of course, the work of the masters of the Bauhaus is an artistic work. It's of the highest value, and therefore it needs to be followed with the precision, discipline, and also the light of the Bauhaus. And that's what I did for many years. As I said, my path was not by starting to go into an architecture office and learn how to build buildings, but I followed and created my own path through drawing, through color, through music, into architecture. And then when I began my project of Micromegas drawings, it was really to explore a new kind of construction, a new kind of space,
a new kind of realm which drawing can open in architecture, not unlike really the fundamental courses that Bauhaus offered, and not unlike the radicalism of the Bauhaus. I want to really emphasize that Bauhaus was not just, you know, a style, a phenomenon that we can accept as just nice architecture. It was a very bold experiment with incredible risks. And we saw in 1933 how the world collapsed, how culture was swallowed by totalitarian thinking, and how human culture came to an end in a certain way, but it can be reborn. That's what I believe. History is not over. It's not just a story that has a bad ending. It continues, and I think it continues in the works of those who have followed that spirit of investigation. Now, later on, I created another set of drawings, and you know, these are architecture drawings. They're not just graphics. I was never one who wanted to explore imaginary buildings because I knew that a building is a social phenomena. You cannot build a building theoretically. You have to have a client. You have to have a political will. You have to have the ethical justice to create architecture. And so I delved into architecture in a totally different way by creating a sense of construction and program, but without really commissions. And I think that's an important way. How does an architect work if he has no client? How does an architect explore space, explore function, explore forms? And that is a very fundamental set of investigations. I call them chamber works because they were related to the chamber, to the house, to the nuclear chamber, but also to chamber music, which is also a music that continues in my work. Like the Bauhaus, I wanted to deal with machines. Bauhaus was full of the notion of machinery, but I traced my machinery when I did the Biennale projects, for which I won the prize, the Venice Lion. I wanted to restore the sense of where they came from. So this was my reading machine, a kind of construction in a Renaissance sense of where machinery came from, and it didn't come just as a rotating wheel, but really as the rotation of being, so to speak, through all the key phenomena. And I wrote the eight texts, the eight last words, so to speak, of the technology which the machines represented. I also created the memory machine, which was related to a very different sense how history has moved. And it was not unrelated to the machines of the Bauhaus, but aesthetically it was not any longer obsessed by the fictitious technological ideas that many have found in the Bauhaus. And I created also an interactive writing machine, writing architecture machine, in which a public could really create a city. It was a program how to design a city. And I thought it was through reading, through writing, and through memory. And those were, I cannot go further into these machines, but they were really created by me with my students in a sense of the Bauhaus recovery of history and of memory. As I said, I met many teachers of the Bauhaus in my life. One of the people I met was Erwin Strauss's wife. Erwin Strauss, famous psychiatrist, who opened the first clinic together with Sigmund Freud in Vienna. He was a professor at a university which I taught, University of Kentucky. His wife was a violin teacher in the Bauhaus in Dessau. And when I had a chance to create the scenography and costume for Tristan and Isolde, for Wagner, I thought to move away from the figurative romanticism of what Wagner operas have become and really delve into the structure of the Wagnerian motifs and recreate them in a way which is not the sentimentality and the nostalgia of a world, but a world that is opened by that music. I also not only did the scenography and costumes, but I also directed, luckily for me, in the Deutsche Oper Berlin, St. François d'Assise, and I was involved, just like in the Bauhaus, with weaving, with cloth, with clothing, with the design. I think it's part of that sphere which cannot be separated from daily life. And I think all the things that Bauhaus courses really provided were about the integrity of incorporating not just some nice forms, but the meaning of life itself. And you can see here, influenced by machines, I attempted to reinterpret François d'Assise, not as a spiritual mysticist, but as a mechanical engine, as Bergson said, a machine that creates gods themselves. So that was an attempt, and later on in Luigi Nono, one of my favorite composers, I had a chance to work on Intolleranza and create also a new sense of proportion of the human body, the ground, the sky, and so on. In Berlin, Moscow exhibition, I had a good chance in 1995 to realize a very difficult exhibition. It was the first exhibition to display Soviet art, propaganda art of Stalin, but also Hitler art, art of the Nazi period. And I was glad to have this chance to create the Berlin-Moscow intersection here in Martin Gropius Bau with large-scale exhibition design. And exhibition design is also part of the world we live in. And I created here a very new way of looking at the color red, at the color black. How does that great art and the longing in even totalitarian art move away into something that has to do with human beings and human desire? I also created, really, this is not only one of the models, but I have a number of models, for a monument to Mies van der Rohe, across that red line moving upwards. That was my interest, which led me then to my really first competition. I never entered a competition before, and my first competition that I was lucky to win for the IBA in Berlin, the City Edge project, which was a housing project, but it was not either a vertical skyscraper or a horizontal skyscraper, but a new sort of new sense of oblique in the city, bringing together many activities, freeing the ground, and really delving into what could sustainable building really be, which minimizes the impact of building on the earth and gives quality to buildings. This was a project which was also featured in the exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art, at the Deconstructivist exhibition, but it showed that architecture also was moving into directions of new sense of exploration, a new sense of form, a new sense of function. And when I competed in the Potsdamer Platz competition, I didn't treat Potsdamer Platz as a tabula rasa, as many of the architects did. I thought there was a lot of history in this site that cannot be mimicked any longer, that cannot just be replicated, but can be brought back through the fragments, through the pieces of the puzzling pieces of history, which are also three-dimensional, which have a social program, which have a strange interconnectedness in a realm which we don't often see. And Alexanderplatz competition, which I was inspired very much by the left hand, and it's important that it was not the right hand, it was the left hand of Alexander Dobrin, with all the capacity of what it means to work. And I appreciated, since I grew up in Poland, how the East is not, East Berlin is not just a place to exercise ideas from elsewhere. It should grow out of Alexanderplatz itself, out of the history of working people, out of the history of greatness of Berlin. And I really provided, I would say, a kind of homeopathic approach. I didn't tear any buildings down. I suggested renovation of the buildings, reusing the fabric, bettering streets, creating more facilities for people who work, creating places for kids and families. So it was not really a project aligned with, at that time, the thinking of Berlin, which was just to create something completely new, but it was a project to improve gradually the character of the streets, the character of buildings, building using existing footprints of buildings. Then I was lucky to build the Felix Nussbaum Museum and the Jewish Museum in Berlin, which really my first buildings themselves. But I want to go back that to me, the craft, for example, woodworking, working in steel, working in ceramics, working in different materials is important. It doesn't come just from, you know, choosing materials for a pretty facade, but from the internal need to work with materials. And I think that's something that Bauhaus certainly propelled into the future. And here in Futuropolis, which I created with the students of the University of St. Gallen, who are, by the way, not architecture students, they were lawyers, students in education, students in business. I wanted to create from wood, the sort of interactive work that brings people together through wood constructions and through functionality of what that wood construction can create, both on an immediate domestic level, but also on a social and urban level. Recently, I was able to complete a project called The Anatomy of Architecture in Bologna, where I reversed the perspective head of Piero della Francesca. It exists only in a drawing. I recreated the projection system And I created a really a mirror view of what those eyes, what those brains, what those amazing masters of the Renaissance, which also underpinned the masters of the Bauhaus, really thought, and how could we project ourselves into the rays of their intuitions as to the eternity of beauty of life. Now, that brings me to something very pedestrian, because Bauhaus taught me that you cannot just think just big ideas about the world. You also have to think of the immediate. And we know the famous Bauhaus door handles, but we need to also door handles in new buildings. And so I got into the design of small things. I was able to design this tea set, stainless steel tea set. Really, you can see, inspired by new geometries, because we are no longer just living in the world of the orthogonal. We are no longer living in the world of 1920, 1930. We have new possibilities of thinking, of doing, of creating. We have three-dimensional printing. So one has to update the Bauhaus, update the capacity of the Bauhaus to deal with modern technology. And just today, I sat at the desk of Walter Gropius. What a beautiful desk. And look at the telephone, the huge, heavy telephone. Now, of course, if Gropius was with us today, he would be using the iPhone, because it's beautiful. I was also able to design a lamp. And these are projects in production. These are not theoretical projects, because I believe that really it's about the environment as a whole. Social environment, cultural environment, aesthetic environment. And every object, this is a lamp for Artemida, which you can see is just a straight line, which can be broken into many different configurations through a wire intention within that form. And also creating furniture, creating tables, creating chairs for Cassina, for other companies, for many projects that I'm pursuing in my work. The chairs, the crystal chairs from my project at the Royal Ontario Museum. So again, architecture as part of a totality, and I think that's the beauty of the Bauhaus. It was the Gesamtkunstwerk, related in some ways to Wagner's idea, but in a very progressive way, in a way that moved forward the human mind and also the human soul. And I was able to, on a larger scale later on, this is 97, create outdoor installations that create a magnet for a space. This is in Japan, in Wazoo. It's a line, the red line that takes you from the bottom of the mountain to an observatory, which you don't see, it's beyond it, which I also built. And in the polders of Holland, I was able to build what I call the Garden of Love and Fire, a steel structure with canals to bring new land into usefulness and into identity, because people don't know these lands. They're just newly created out of nowhere. And recently in Dublin, where I constructed a large theater, 2,500 seats, I was able to create this work which is also related to Bauhaus, to the wall tapestries, to the typography. This one is based on one of my favorite authors that I'm sure the Bauhaus masters read, James Joyce's Finnegan's Wake, because it has, you know, the 100 letter words of God. And I reverse them here. It's an atrium that connects itself to the theater itself. It's a work at large public scale, but it's not just a memorial to James Joyce, it's a memorial to the memory of the thunder. And thunder is always part of architecture, and then there's also lightning in architecture. I couldn't leave this without saying that I'm interested in social housing, in workers' housing, not just housing for the rich. This is a project done for Sri Lanka, and I'm now pursuing projects of this sort for very low-cost workers' housing in China. And I think it's very important that the ethical idea of the Bauhaus, which was about people, was about affordability, making sure that the works are not expensive, that they really are for working people, because that's primarily what the world is about. And I think social justice is a very important aspect in what I believe a house is. And I had a chance to create for a couple in very close to New York a house, and I thought of the great houses that I love, created in the Bauhaus. What is a house today? And I was able to create a stainless steel house, a house that is a continuous space, very modest. It's not a huge house, but a house that also has a very warm interior. It's a completely solid wood interior. It's a very sustainable house. Does not have big glass panes. It just opens itself to the landscape, to the light. in ways which are economic and sustainable. You can see the stainless steel structure actually comes into the house, and the house has, of course, all the facilities, the kitchen, and the pleasures of the portraits, of reinterpreting, really, the Bauhaus idea of what is the ideal house. And I think every architect loves to do a house, because a house is not a repetition of something, not a formula, but always connected to the life of people, to the pleasures of living, and to the economy of a building. So you can see here, I was lucky enough to be able to design in this house almost everything, the lighting, the fixtures. I didn't design the refrigerator, but I designed almost everything else. I show you even the sink, but that there is a cultural message here, that it's not about the size of a building that matters. It's not how high a building is. It's how high is the aspiration, the spiritual sense of what a building represents, what a piece of environment represents. And so this house gave me a chance, on a very, very small scale, to think once again of something primordial, which is the cave. How can we live in the world? How can we occupy a small footprint and yet bring dignity to a couple living, in this case, a beautiful landscape and a beautiful place, a house that shifts the house away from the box, away from those glass boxes, away from the Cartesian geometries, into new realms. Heritage is something very important. And I have had a chance to work in China. I did not often work in China because I like transparency and democracy and tolerance. But I worked with a visionary who wanted to bring attention to the great Zhang Zhidang, who, as you may not know, was the founder of industry of China in Wuhan, center of China. And I based the building on many aspects of Wuhan, of industry, of the history of the Chinese Revolution of 1911, the Xinhai Revolution, which brought really modernity to China, and to create a building that will speak to that modernity, connect itself to history. You can see the way the topography of the building works. You can see that it is part of the steelworks, which will become really transformed by new planning. And it's a building that aspires to create a different sense of space, in not a space for propaganda, not a space for show, but really for people. It's a steel structure. It's part of the steel company that funds it. It's a grand theater of the environment from which you can see the developments of Wuhan. And it's also a very challenging new structure that elevates the building high up, creating really a urban space that connects neighbors to the site. Trauma is another aspect of something that I'm interested in, because so much of the world, and we saw it in those pictures of 1933, the destruction of culture, the complete contempt for the individual, the loss of liberty, totalitarian thinking, conformity, all the things which I reject and dislike. That is part of my project in Dresden, one of the most beautiful cities in the world. I truly love Dresden. And I had a chance to win a competition for really how to bring the Military History Museum in this historical site, which has always been an armory and then a museum, and often a museum under totalitarian conditions of the Nazis, of the Soviets in East Germany. But a museum that again, looks in a different way to reality. And you can see the restoration of the horizontal armory, and that vector which points really in its self-similar form to the triangulation from which Dresden itself was destroyed in the Allied bombings of 1945, and gives us a view of the city and a view of the interruption between 1914 and 1945 of human history. And I think it's a building that I wanted public to be able to move through in a new space, of course, coordinated with the armory, which was never meant to be a museum, but also to cut through it and create a kind of transparency that moves through the building, connecting the horizontal history of the armory with the history of questions. Why do people follow blindly leaders? And I was shocked to see how animals have been used in wars, from way back of lions and elephants to today, dogs in space, cats, the abuse of nature that human beings are capable of, and also to derealize and demystify the weapons of war. It's not about weapons, it's about how to bring peace to the world, how to see the tragedy of what humanity is involved in its technology, and how to see what comes from the sky, what attacks us, and the horizon of the city, many destroyed cities in Europe, from Dresden, from Berlin, cities destroyed in my hometown, in my home country, in Poland, in Holland, in the UK, but also to give a projection outward where you can be suspended in space beyond the building and where you have a view from this slot of the beauty of a new Dresden, which is rising really on the horizon, and the delicacy of preserving the history. It's not a destruction of history. It's not something that just cuts out the history and creates something new, but a very delicate transformation through almost a fabric-like effect to create a new interest in a democracy about questions which cannot easily be answered. Why do people do those things? Why do they go that way? Why do we have fundamentalism? We have to ask those questions and pose them to the visitors. Neighborhood is something very important to me, because I had a chance, many chances, to design an entire neighborhood. This is in Singapore, at Keppel Bay, an old industrial neighborhood, disused, and I had a chance to create a high-density, extreme high-density environment. This is an environment of thousands and thousands of apartment units, both low, and also I got the permission to create very high towers, which were not just extrusions in that Cartesian way, as if that was the most practical way, but towers that sway in the wind, so to speak, doubly curved towers that really compose a very high energy environment, so that every individual is counted not as a statistic in a building, but as a view, as a sense of space, sense of belonging, sense of amenities, and there are many families who live here, clubhouses, restaurants. So again, it's a model that a neighborhood can also become an architecturally, artistically important place. And of course, Singapore is a very small country, so to preserve the nature, green space, one has to build dense and give something back to the city, which creates a social interaction, these green bridges between the buildings, and the drama of architecture, which, just like this Bauhaus building, as I was looking at it, you know, when it was built, it was such a shock. Today, we almost take it for granted, but it was a shock. But tomorrow's buildings will also look rather different than we expect them to look. And then I bring you finally to a very important project, because I'm also a New Yorker. You know, I'm from Poland, I'm from Israel, I'm from Berlin, but I'm also from New York. And when I won the competition, not just for the Freedom Tower, but for the master plan of Ground Zero, how do you bring back life to this void in the city? I didn't think just of buildings, I thought of people, I thought of the human scale, I thought of the symbols of America, symbols of tolerance, of freedom, of the Statue of Liberty, of going down to the bedrock. And as you know, it's not easy. Politically, emotionally, we have so many stakeholders, we have so many people involved, so much money involved, so much power involved. But look, this is on the left, my first sketch, and on the right is the latest rendering. And that's what I wanted to do, create as much as possible public space. This is a 16-acre site, very small, but the density of this site is almost as big as a downtown of Denver, or downtown of Baltimore, or downtown of Philadelphia. It has millions of square feet of development. I wanted to create place for people, place for culture, and a new neighborhood that isn't just oppressive with shadows, but has light onto the memorial. A completely new neighborhood, really connecting Tribeca, Wall Street, Battery Park, Chinatown, and to create it with a sense of memory, but also a sense of the future. This was the foundation that we should have never have seen, that the slurry wall, the big dam on the left side is the Hudson River pushing it. If this wall had collapsed, all of the subways would have been flooded. So I thought that is important as an experience for visitors to have. And indeed, next year, the museum will open, the September 11th museum, and you will see this amazing foundation, which should have never been revealed, and it's difficult because foundations are usually built in order to be covered. I was able to leave it open and show how New York is built from the bedrock, where people have perished, 3,000 people almost, from 94 different countries. And I think that's important, that this was an attack that changed the world. It was an attack not only against America, it was an attack against everything that we believe in. And what do we believe in? We believe in the public space. We believe in people being together. We believe in creating the footprints of the buildings as memory, with the visitor center taking you down below, the names of the victims really around the waterfalls. And it was my idea from the very beginning to bring water, because first of all, it's a natural element. It brings a healing sense of something positive to the hardscape of New York in Lower Manhattan, but it also screens the sight of busy streets, cars, so you can have an intimate experience, a human experience at this very, very highly visited site. And I want to tell you that today there have been more than 10 million people to the memorial, even though it's still a construction site. There it is, one of my early drawings with a torch, as I call it, inspired by the Statue of Liberty. I didn't create a mega structure like many architects, one huge building or two huge buildings. I wanted to make as many low buildings as possible, so I distributed the density into many buildings in order to make them lower, so the streets have a better sense, so there's no wind tunnels, so there's no shadows onto the memorial, so there is the pleasure of great streets of New York, and I created an extra space, which I call the Wedge of Light. It is space determined by the 2 hours of the tragedy, 8:46 in the morning, when the first tower was struck, and 10:28, when the second tower collapsed, which is now the center of the new PATH terminal under construction. It will be a very dramatic memorial in the light of New York. And of course, it is about the values. It is about people. It is about working together. And this is a site from my office, from my studio in New York. I see the site every day from the minute we have moved back to New York after I won the competition. You can see the Freedom Tower reaching conclusion, tower number 4, tower number 3 is already highly visible, tower number 2 will start, the station is under construction, the memorial is finished, and I end here where I really began, because it is about liberty. It's not about slogans, but it is about human liberty. And we live in a time where there is a pressure on the individuality, a pressure on liberty. We see the demise of ideologies. We see wars, unjust wars, fought in the world. So yes, I went back, that's what it is. That's what it says on the Statue of Liberty. Give me your tired, give me your poor, give me the huddled masses who want to be free. Thank you.
Biografie ist in den jeweiligen Bauten drin, beziehungsweise spielt eine Rolle, denn allein das Thema Freiheit, was wir hier hinter uns noch sehen, ist ja auch ein Lebensmotiv, das sich durch die Familie zieht.
Well, I think the pretension that architecture, social life is without biography is false. We know from the great founders of the Bauhaus, of Mies van der Rohe, of Kandinsky, we know that their biographies were also the authenticity of their artworks and their architecture work. So I have never believed in neutral architecture. I never believed in a neutral box, in the idea that I never liked neutrality anyway. I don't like neutrality. I like to take a position. And I want to assert the fact that the work is rooted in something real. It's not just a formal exercise, a consumer product. But it is hinged in history, and often the history is difficult. It's not an easy history in any of these projects. And even in a regular project, which is on a green site, a house, you know, in Connecticut, I often thought about there is history. There are American Native people who have been displaced from these sites. We don't see it. We just see a nice green site in Connecticut. But my house is related to those stories as well.
Wir wollen zum Bauhaus kommen. Sie sind ja sehr froh, dass Sie diese neue Reihe hier eröffnen. Wir wollen in Zukunft auf dem Weg nach 2019 wichtige Designer, Architekten, Museumsleute einladen, um über ihre Philosophie zu reden. Wenn man ihnen heute dieses Bauhaus geben würde und sagt, mach was draus, wen würden sie einladen, brauchen sie dafür viel Geld, was würden sie machen?
You know, the spirit is immune to money. The spirit does not need, the spirit goes where it wants. It's not about money. I don't think it has anything to do with budgets. It has to do with the human desire. And I know so many amazing dancers, musicians, composers, artists, people who make incredible wood things, people who are experts in making new materials, new technologies. That would be my idea. I think it's not the outside of the building, it's the inner spirit. And what I've always admired about the Bauhaus is that every one of those individuals had a luminous spirit. It was a spirit that has gone into the future. And even though the buildings were destroyed in 1945, you can see the catastrophe that befell Germany, from Germany, you can see that the spirit moved elsewhere. It moved to America. I was so lucky to have Bauhaus teachers. I was so lucky to be in Chicago, in Detroit, where the Bauhaus spirit with Charles Eames and others continued to live. So I believe in continuity. And, you know, that to me is the key. And, well, if you give me the job, I think I can do it.
Jetzt stellen wir uns mal vor, der Oberbürgermeister stellt Ihnen sofort morgen einen Platz zur Verfügung. Wen würden Sie einladen?
You know, I don't want to mention names, but creativity is at the core of the Bauhaus. Bauhaus is about creativity. And creativity is the foundation of the city. Cities sometimes go through decline, they fall apart. But the only way to reorganize and bring back life to a city, and we were talking about Detroit, we're talking about some of the industrial cities in the former East. The only way to do it is through creativity. And I know it from Berlin, because I lived for many years in Berlin. How amazing the creativity of people in Berlin, artists, poets, writers, who move through the city and open the way for others. And of course, unfortunately, the rents get higher. but I think creativity, to me, is the core value. And how do you foster, what is creativity? Creativity is tremendous risks. Creativity is not a comfortable life. It is not a comfort of the future. It is fighting for something that many people will say cannot ever succeed. But I think it will always succeed. If there is human desire, if there is authentic work, if there is labor, I think we have seen this in history. Impossible things do happen. Bauhaus is one of them.
Wir sind ja gerade auch dabei, im Kuratorium im Bauhaus die Themenlinien zu entwickeln für 2019 unter der großen Überschrift Die Welt neu denken. Wir sind fest davon überzeugt, dass Gropius, Kandinsky, Klee, wie sie alle hier zusammengearbeitet haben, damals auch die Welt neu denken wollten. Die wollten nicht nur bauen, die wollten Lebensstil entwickeln, die wollten eine Sicht auf die Welt in Form bringen. Was müsste man heute machen? Was wären heute die Formen 100 Jahre später? Was müsste man heute tun? Was für Themen würde man im Bauhaus entwickeln?
I think you're right. It's about an ethical and political sense of justice. It's not, as I said, just building because there's a commission. It's being committed to social causes. And very often people think this doesn't work. That, you know, I believe in participatory design. I believe in public participating, not just as a voice, but actually in creating buildings. And I'm working on a building for Leuphana University, which I developed with students of not architecture, lawyers, doctors, engineers. Of course, they are not architects, but I gave them pencils, I gave them computers, and they were able to say, what do we need? There was no program, there was an idea. So I do believe that. Of course, Bauhaus is full of ghosts, but let's not make them ghosts. You know, in Karl Marx's Das Kapital, the first line, it says there is a ghost which is roaming around Europe. So there can be a kind of a ghost of the Bauhaus. We look at these figures fixed in time as if they are fixed there, but they're not. They're living. They are alive. The specter that is a living being. And to me, Kandinsky is more alive than many of the successful artists who display their works in major museums today. So it is about fostering a sense of cooperative spirit, of a political engagement. And I have to say, every project is political, you know, because every project needs a permission to be built, a legality. Even a small house in Connecticut, the neighbors said, you know, is it really a UFO that has landed from outer space? Well, I said it didn't land from the Connecticut space. It came from elsewhere. It did.
Was sollten denn heute Architekturstudenten noch von diesem Bauhausgeist lernen? Ist das für die Architekturgeschichte 100 Jahre alt, spielt eigentlich keine Rolle mehr? Oder ist das heute tatsächlich noch in der Ausbildung präsent? Lernt man wirklich noch was von diesem Bauhausgeist? Der war ja nur ganz wenige Jahre zu spüren und hat doch so eine große Wirkung entfaltet.
I think we can learn a lot when we delve into the works of the Bauhaus. Because they are not about the right angle. They are not about the glass wall. Of course they are about technology, they are about efficiency, they are about ergonomics, they are about the character of forming a new human, a new idea, a new ideal of a non-sentimental, not nostalgic, not exploitive individual. That is a kind of a paradise, a view of paradise. And I think, to me, that is the core of the Bauhaus. Those ideas are alive. And if we delve into any of the courses of the Bauhaus, we can see that they were never meant to be just syllabus for teachers to follow, but a provocation to continue and extend them into contemporary realms. So I see a great future of the Bauhaus. In fact, the architects who I admire, the designers I admire, whose works may not at all look like Bauhaus, you know, of Gropius or of Poclay or of Itten, really pursue the Bauhaus because they love those things. And what are those things? It's a love for construction. It's a love for working with other people. It's a love to explore something that can be built and can be afforded by working people. So I think that's the mission. We have more and more injustice. We have the rich and the poor, and great design seems to be associated with affluence. You know, if you have a lot of luxury, you can have a nice building or a nice city. But to me, that's not true. We need workers' housing. We need low-cost housing. And it needs to be done not just as a formula, but as a reinvention of what is contemporary life about.
Und kennen die Studenten noch Bauhaus? Lernen die das noch?
Absolutely. I think the buildings can teach you something. You know, the objects themselves, the spaces, the light, the connection to the world, to the earth, can teach you, but not by itself. I think you need a human guide to take you through this labyrinth of the objective world into the fire that is at the core of the soul. And there may be a small flame in the soul, but it can be fanned into a big flame, into a big fire that can consume the irrelevant things that are in the world and create a field, a new sense of openness.
Nun sind Sie ja nicht nur in der westlichen Welt unterwegs, sondern auch in Asien, China, Singapur, viele andere Plätze, Afrika, Südamerika. Ist die Bauhaus-Idee eine westliche Idee, eine Idee von Europa und dann auch USA, oder ist das eine inzwischen auch eine globale Idee?
Bauhaus is definitely a global idea, but the Bauhaus, at that time they did not have access to everything we know. We know many things that people in the Bauhaus were not aware of. We have new communications possibilities. We can travel. We can see things that without that ideological filter that was so close to them. So the world has changed, definitely. It is not the same world. But the universal idea that human beings are human, they all have a brain, they have eyes, they have hands, they are not God, they are mortal. I think that idea is a powerful idea of the Bauhaus because it's about the human being. And I think at the end, the beauty of the Bauhaus is that it returned through the objective world of technology, through the mega structure of cities, back to what does it mean to be a worker? What does it mean to be in a house? What does it mean to open a door with a door handle? What does it mean to welcome somebody, a stranger, to the house? I think those ideas are at the core of the Bauhaus.
Wir diskutieren ja gerade im Stiftungsrat auch den Neubau eines Museums. Wir haben gesehen, viele Museen haben Sie gebaut. Würden Sie in Dessau ein Museum eher in Richtung so der klassischen Bauhausarchitektur bauen oder was ganz Ungewohntes, vielleicht auch Verrücktes versuche. Ich meine, man sieht ja durchaus, Sie nehmen ja immer, Neighborhood spielt eine große Rolle. Und well, Dessau hat viel Bauhaus Neighborhood. Also
well, you know, if something is just mediocre, then people will shake their hand and head and say that it's good. Mediocrity always gets an applause. I think things which are not mediocre have a more difficult birth. They are more like a child. You know, I have five grandchildren. When children are born, it's a difficult process. It's not very pretty. A real work of art is not really nice looking. Doesn't have to be nice looking because it goes through an authentic sense of being born. The fake products look very nice and very acceptable. But I think the core of a project has to be reinventing the program, reinventing the space, reinventing the communication. And to me, every building is a story. Every building has to tell a story. Such a project as pursuing the Bauhaus would have to tell really a very, very new story of the Bauhaus, a very shocking story also of the Bauhaus.
Es gab ja auch Ideen, sozusagen alles unterirdisch zu bauen, aber ich glaube, wir bleiben über der Erde.
I like to be in the sky. I think architecture is not something you can hide. You cannot hide it, and you need not hide it. If it's bad, people hide it, like bunkers and underground infrastructure. But I think good architecture, like walking on a street, looking at the sky, meeting a friend, is something in the open horizon, and I think that's what makes it truly important.
Wenn man nach so einer Tragödie wie in New York dann daran geht, so ein wirklich emotional, politisch, auch sensibel Ort, der so aufgeladen ist, neu zu gestalten, wie lange geht man um diesen Ort drumherum? Also Sie sind New Yorker, Sie arbeiten mit Blick auf diesen wirklich ganz besonderen, auch für Amerika extrem sensitiven und sensiblen Ort. Wie lange dauert das, bis man dann wirklich eine Idee bekommt, so eine neue Fackel der Freiheit zu entwickeln?
It's a great effort. You know, I was told by many critics and many newspapers to give up, you know, because there's so many stakeholders involved. We've got the families of the victims, which are in the thousands, you know, mothers, daughters, sons, fathers who lost members of their families, thousands. We have the Port Authority, one of the huge organizations with 7,000 engineers and architects, can you imagine, created by Robert Moses, which owns the site and leases the site to private developers and their own architects. We've got the governor of New York and New Jersey who control the Port Authority, highly political. We've got the mayor of New York in charge of the streets of New York. We've got the MTA authority in charge of subways running underneath and PATH trains, another authority. So the only way to create a project is to garner a consensus, to really struggle. It's not and you don't win every battle, but that's democracy. As Winston Churchill said, you know, democracy maybe is not the best system, but it's the best of all the systems we have to do something human. So it takes a lot of, you know, it's a marathon. And I think I would say that even though the Bauhaus was open for a short time, intellectually and culturally, it was a marathon, because it was a marathon towards eternity. It was not a sprint to produce some buildings and door handles. And I think that's true for any authentic work of the city, that it is a long commitment. It's a passion. There is an intensity. You can also fail, but that's part of the consensus, and that's a part of the faith. And without a faith, I think that's what impresses me of the Bauhaus. They had a faith in the future. They were believers. They were not cynics. They were not skeptics. They believed. And I think I'm a believer. You have to be a believer. You don't have to believe in God, but you have to believe deeply in something truly, truly something you're willing to sacrifice your life for. And I think that's really the city, and that's democracy, and that's the struggle. And that's indeed why Ground Zero is not an easy project. It's not a matter of drawing a couple of drawings and having some publicity and going home and relaxing and going. It's a constant commitment, and it's tough. But I have to say it's worth it. You know, when we moved from Poland to Israel, I had another country. Then from Israel to the Bronx, I had another country. But I learned one thing from my parents, who were Holocaust survivors: never give up.
Das muss man. Diesen Satz muss man sich wirklich bei der Biografie und auch bei der Familiengeschichte wirklich sehr besonders merken und nochmal vergegenwärtigen, was das eigentlich im Besonderen heißt. Wenn wir nochmal in die weite Welt hinausgehen, wo sind heute die avantgardistischen Zentren von Städtebau und Architektur? Wo sind heute die kleinen Bauhäuser des 21. Jahrhunderts? Die stehen noch nicht in Dessau, da kommen wir dann noch hin, aber wo sind die Zentren?
It's a very interesting, difficult question to answer, because the world is a pluralistic world and it's more and more open, even in places which were closed just 10 years ago. The world is opening and people are beginning to have access to communication. I work in Brazil, in Sao Paulo, and I see how people in the favelas can organize themselves because they have a telephone. They can organize, you know, where to meet and where to protest and where to ask questions. So I don't think it's any longer just one place that has the possibility, but the connection, the network of connections. Of course, we need also the reality, the real place with history, which can never be substituted by virtual reality. So it's I think it's a dialogue between the network of people, of committed people, and also of places. So as I said, I went to school in New York, where most of the professors were emigres from Berlin, from the Bauhaus. They had to leave because they were avant-garde, because they were Jews, because they were not tolerated. So history also has a diaspora, but now the diaspora is growing. There is so much free thought in China, even though we have a regime that does not tolerate. We have in Russia, we have in Poland, we have a changed world. I think it's a fantastic world. It's a world that's striving towards freedom. And I'm not being, I'm not exaggerating that even regimes that seem to be monolithic and authoritarian can crumble in a second. And I saw this when I came to Berlin, because I moved to Berlin in 1989, in July of 1989. And I was sitting with a famous professor of history at Oxford, who said to me, when we were talking about East and West, he said, we will never see Berlin or Germany unified in our lifetime. And the next week, the wall came down. So that much for experts.
Vielleicht die letzte Frage. Wie beschreiben Sie sich selbst? Sind Sie Architekt, Philosoph? Musiker?
The best answer to this question is by my favorite poet, Emily Dickinson. I don't know if you know her. In English, maybe she's translated in German, but she said, I am nobody. Who are you? Are you nobody too? Then there is a pair of us.
Noch ganz kurz, der Abend ist noch nicht vorbei. Wir haben gesagt, es ist der Beginn des Wochenends der Triennale. wir würden Sie als erstes gerne begrüßen, entweder im Club oder auch im neuen Besucherzentrum, was bis 9 Uhr geöffnet hat, mit uns zu verweilen, Gespräche zu führen und den Vortrag und die Diskussion nachklingen zu lassen. Um 21 Uhr gibt es eine Performance-Installation Meister Klee der Künstlerin Daya von Berner aus Madrid am Prellerhaus, also sagen vor ihm sozusagen. Es gibt zwei Ausstellungen im Kontext der Triennale zu Ernst Neufeld, die ist gestern eröffnet worden an der Hochschule Anhalt. Ein Bauhaus-Schüler, der hier auch am Bauhausgebäude als Mitarbeiter des Baubüro Kropius mitgewirkt hat und eine sehr ambivalente Geschichte auch hat. Und dann eine zweite Ausstellung, die jetzt zu Ende geht, von der Sie sicherlich schon gehört haben, Schwerin Frenkel. Drei Bauhäusler, die nach Palästina emigriert sind, im Meisterhaus Mure Schlemmer. Die Ausstellung endet jetzt am Wochenende und dazu gibt es auch eine Lesung und Kuratorenführung am Sonntag mit Frau Jutta Schwerin. Es gibt morgen einen Tag der offenen Tür in allen Bauhausbauten. Sie können dort alles überall hingehen, auch in Räumen, die Sie sonst nicht sehen. Eine einmalige Chance, die Sie dann erst wieder in 3 Jahren haben, denke ich. Es gibt für Jugendliche einen Workshop Propaganda der Bauhaushass, der morgen und übermorgen stattfindet. Das ist anmeldungsbedürftig wie manches andere. Es gibt morgen um 15 Uhr einen Vortrag von Gunnar von Woltersdorf, dem heutigen Staatsanwalt in der Justizvollzugsanstalt, über dieses Thema der Schließung des Bauhauses durch die Staatsanwaltschaft Dessau. Im Anschluss ein Gespräch mit dem Leiter unserer Sammlung Wolfgang Thüner. Es gibt eine Busrundfahrt zu den Junkersbauten von vor 33 und nach 33 morgen. Es gibt einen Spaziergang mit Sandra Fiedler von Bauhaus bis zu Klon B. Und es gibt auch Besichtigungen von Häusern mit Bewohnern, wie zum Beispiel die Leopold-Fischer-Siedlung, also in Tört mit Frank Wolter, oder auch in Zusammenarbeit mit der Genossenschaft Mieterladen ein. Die Bewohner des Laubenkrankhäusers öffnen ihre Türen und Sie können sehen, wie man in dem Haus wohnt. Auch eine einmalige Chance, weil sonst will man natürlich nicht, man kann nicht täglich Gäste in seine private Wohnung lassen. Am Samstag gibt es eine Performance des Theaters, Song vom letzten Bauhausfest, hier auf der Bauhausbühne. Es gibt mehr, ich habe nur die wichtigsten, 30 Veranstaltungen, einen Flyer. Wir würden Sie freuen, sehr freuen, Sie in den nächsten 2,5 Tagen bei der einen oder anderen Gelegenheit wieder zu sehen. Ich danke sehr, es ist eine gemeinsame Initiative der Stadt. Herr Hantusch ist da, in seinem Dezernat ist es gelaufen, in Kooperation mit uns, auch gemeinsam finanziert mit Förderung des Landes. Ich hoffe, wir haben ein tolles Wochenende miteinander und einen schönen Abend. Vielen Dank.